Hello, good evening. Yeah, let's well give a warm welcome to Professor Sudha Shastri. She's a multi-talented woman. she not only is a professor in English in the humanities and social sciences department, you know, she had been a star student. I just saw her profile. She's a gold medalist in her MA program, and she's placed first in the state in her BA program. And she also has a beautiful, you know, like a teaching award from IIT Bombay. So she has many things. Of course, we all don't like to talk about, you know. But more than that, you know, I just want to tell you that she's a great singer. She's an Hindustani classical singer and an Odissi dancer. Yeah, you should watch her YouTube videos. She's really good. So with that, we welcome her. We are very happy that she could, that she could take time to come here. Hopefully by the end of her talk and after we receive some books that we have ordered for you, when you read and make a book report sort of a thing, I think you'll appreciate literature, because you know, many of us as engineers think that that is all we need to know, you know. But literature and arts, they bring you another dimension to all the things that we see and do. So hopefully you will become very appreciative of literature after you hear her talk. And we hope, and we again thank her for coming, even though it's raining and it's bad weather. And thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that, very kind.
Yeah, and the interns, you know, like I am also getting to know them only now. How many interns today? Just put up your hands. We can do a count quickly. 12, about only 15 of them are here today. But we have a total of 29, right? And the ones in Bombay, I think, have not come, or if they have come, they have disappeared because they want to go back home. And 4 or 5 of them have gone to visit their family. 21 or 22 only there? 20? Interns, okay. But today there are only, I could count only 15, 16, 17, yeah. Okay. We are taking attendance though. So we'll have a proper count at the end of this. And so they have all come here as winners of our Yantra Robotics competition, which is a national level competition from all across the country, from Bangalore to Delhi to Allahabad to, you know, all different places. From Shimoga, Karnataka. So, and they're getting to know each other and getting exposed to many interesting talks. So hopefully, you know, you will take the most advantage of all the things you hear and see today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Saraswati, for that very nice, very kind and very flattering introduction. I'm not sure I can live up to everything that you have said about me. Can you hear it there? Can you hear me now through the mic? Okay. Thank you. So this talk, why we read literature, I don't have a structured talk in place, and that's my first confession to you. But I hope that as the sort of this thing progresses, that between us we'll be able to find some answers to this question of why we read literature. So I want this to be as interactive as possible. I hope that's all right with you. If I had a little more time, I would ask each one of you to introduce yourself and tell me your name. I think there may not be time for that. So. I want to stop at 6 o'clock. So we will, you know, maybe that will emerge as the talk progresses, okay? So I saw a tentative abstract which was written next to my talk. Perhaps you saw it too. It said, why do we read literature? How do we read texts? And what texts do we read? Why do we read? And also the problems of interpretation and so on, right? Can you hear me in the back? Can you hear me in the back? You can? Okay. If you can't hear me, just tell me, because I can't hear myself very well. I teach English literature, as Saraswati said, to undergraduate students of engineering, BTech students of this institute. And I am guessing your profile sort of matches their profile. And so it's possible that I have come here with certain preconceptions about engineering students and their attitudes towards literature. Coming from my own personal experience, they could be right, they could be wrong. So maybe that's a good sort of place from where to start today's lecture, today's talk. So So I am assuming that most of you think that reading literature is not relevant, that literature is not useful, that literature doesn't have much value, that you're willing to go as far as to say, yes, it's fun, I enjoy getting, beguiled by a world which is very interesting, but it doesn't have actual utility value or use. Am I right? How many of you want to say yes? You can raise your hands, there are no penalties for saying literature is not. Only one person, everybody else thinks that literature is a great thing, so I shouldn't even be giving this talk, you should be giving it. Why is it a great thing? What use is it? Why didn't you do a major in literature? Why are you learning engineering? No, obviously, right, if you think that, so somewhere you feel that it doesn't have a career value. You don't think or you think? It has a career value, like what? Somebody else, why would you not want to invest in a career in literature? I am gradually moving my talk that in that direction. Why do you think that, I am assuming again, this is one of my assumptions, I am assuming that you think that it's good to read a book, it's fun to read a book, but it's not worth investing 4 years of your education time in majoring in reading books or specializing in reading books. Am I right? I am, right. So why? Why do you think it's not worthwhile? I put up some stuff very randomly on the board. Look at it and give me an answer if you like, but why do you think? Is that what you think, that you think that it's okay to read these books, but these books are not going to be meaningful in a materialistic fashion? It's not going to give you a career in the way being a software engineer would give you a career, am I right? So shall I say that the way the educational system is framed today, anywhere in the world, reading literature is not equivalent to ensuring you a great career or good money or success or fame, unless you want to be, you are lucky enough to become a Booker Prize winner or something. Am I right? So that is what your general opinion is about literature. So you don't, so this question of why we read literature, it may not seem like to me, probably is not a very important question for you. You have not probably engaged with it because you think you know the answer. Am I right? You think you know that there is no point reading literature beyond a certain fashion. Am I right? Yes. Okay. Now, if I try to convince you that there is value in reading literature and that it requires a certain readjustment of the way in which we define the word value, will you be able to accept what I say? Or do you want to give me an hour's time and then decide at the end of the hour whether you agree with me or not? You agree already? No, very good. I don't have people who agree with me immediately. All right. Okay. So I want to, of course, I can't give you any great miraculous answers about, see, reading literature. I thought as much. I'm not audible. So what can I do? I have a very good idea. Why don't you come here? Come. I don't think they are even listening, to be honest. I saw them talking to each other. So, and I'm not going to pressurize anyone to listening to me. Maybe you can come here. And are you both listening? Can hear me, right? You can't hear. You didn't say it so far. Okay, can you hear me now? Why don't I do this simpler? So I'm going to put to you certain ideas that I have, which are not completely original ideas, ideas for which I'm indebted to friends like Deepa, students, and also, this whole experience of having taught for a very long time. Where is Pallash? Okay, so ideas that I'm indebted to students and friends for, they are not original ideas, but I'm going to discuss these ideas here with you. And as I said, let this be an interactive session so that if you want to endorse what I'm saying or you want to reject what I'm saying, feel free to interrupt me. Is that all right? Okay. So we have begun with the assumption that there is no use in reading literature because literature doesn't guarantee anything in the real world. Before I go on to address this problem, I will define very quickly what I mean by literature, because although we all vaguely sort of know what literature means, I'll be more specific and say that by literature I mean imaginative writing. Okay, fiction can be poetry, it can be drama, it can be plays, it can be anything. A text which deals with a world which is completely imagined, which may have some resemblance to the world that we live in. More or less resemblance. If it's an historical novel, it will have more resemblance. If it is a fantasy novel, it will probably have no resemblance. Okay, but it is a world which we know is not to be taken very seriously, is not to be taken as a real world, because what happens in the real world, what happens in that world of imagination has no impact for you in the real world. Isn't that the way we generally understand reading literature? yeah, it's good to read. Maybe you learn something. Maybe you get, you know, sort of hold of some values. But at the end of it, how does it make any meaningful change in the way you live your life or life works for you? That's probably the reservation that we have about reading literature. Now, I'm going to suggest that this is not the way in which we have to look at literature. In several ways, I have put up some of those things here, why the role of the imagination is important and so on. But don't feel restricted by the points that I have put up for myself as a reminder to say in this talk that this is why I think literature is important. If you are willing to suspend your belief that literature is not important and consider that maybe it is very important, then you know you can also add to the talk that I'm going to give. So I think the first thing that I will challenge is this idea that literature has no real life implications. We are all agreed that there is an idea that it's a belief that literature has no real life implications. So that means, I would say, in defense of the fact that literature has real life implications, I would say that you're narrowing real life, or you're reading the word real life in a very narrow way. If you think that if you read a novel, you can't be influenced by what that novel says to such an extent that you take a different look at the things that you have been looking at in a certain way so far, it means that you have not really understood the impact of fiction on yourself or the real world. Do you get what I'm saying? If you haven't, if you think that I speak too fast, because many people do, I can repeat what I'm saying. I'm saying that you read a book, you read a novel, a completely imaginary piece of writing, and something about that story, something about some character in that story affected you so deeply or influenced you so much that that person or that character or that story, the way it ended, changed the way in which you looked at certain things in your real life. Now, will you agree that this is good enough an impact of literature on real life? At least individually, personally speaking, for you, that book had meaning. It may not have influence in the way that, you know, learning a scientific fact has influence, because everybody who learns that scientific fact learns it in the same way. Forgive me if I'm making a lot of generalizations about science, because I left reading science in class 12. That's like many years ago. But what I am trying to say is that literature affects us or impacts us individually, and I think that's the whole excitement of reading literature. Because no two people, no two readers need to take away the same thing from the same book that they read. Are you with me so far? Okay, now, even though you might not think literature is very relevant, I'm sure everybody here has read novels of some kind or the other. So will three or four of you just tell me what novels you read which made a lasting impact on you? Not the novels which you didn't bother to read. Would you like to say what novel you read, Pallash, which made a lasting impact on you? They get a mic as well. They get a mic. A different way. 1984 is a very good example. Now, is there anybody else here who can give me a more specific example of any book that she or he read which enabled her to give a, do a rethink on what he or she believed? Yes, very good. The Kite Runner. Okay, why? What did it make you think in a different way about? Can you speak up? Because I think I'm not sure they can hear you in that at that corner. Okay, so first of all, I don't think it's the Middle East, I think it's Afghanistan. Okay, fine. But you know, you're telling me that what you're telling me about the impact the novel had on you, fair enough, but that is the same impact that a history book or a geography book, not geography, perhaps a documentary about Afghanistan would have had on you, right? So in that case, the question remains, why read literature? Can you think of a better answer? Something that, you know, what I mean is something that is so literature or imaginative writing specific, that something that book, a completely imaginary book or imagined book, not imaginary book, sorry, a book which is imagined, which deals with imaginary characters and people, etc., has changed you in some fashion. Because I mean, that's the crux of the question, right? That's a very interesting, yes, very good point. Also, we have had this whole tradition of discussion about how you can't imagine something unless you have been impacted by some real life. But I will tread very carefully there, because that doesn't explain science fiction or fantasy in some ways. Because, you know, how does, even you're creating a completely fantastic world, it's a world which has no connection with your world, then it clearly hasn't been impacted by the real world, right? But yes, it's true that there are books, especially, you know, historical novels, for example. You have read a certain part of history, you want to rewrite that history, or you want to, you know, fill in some gaps which you felt that historical record hasn't given you, you write a historical novel. But is there anybody here, I am disappointed, somebody should tell me about some novel, at least one novel that they read, which made them think, or think differently about something they had been thinking about. Yours was good enough. My only worry is that it is not something that something other than a novel could not have done. That's why I'm a little worried. Okay, what did it tell you about how IIT students behave, is it? How you should perceive what? Give me an example, give me a concrete example. Okay. Has anyone read 1984? Maybe I will give the books now. Has anybody read 1984? No. Has anybody read To Kill a Mockingbird? Has anybody watched the film? Okay. You have. You watched the film. Okay, let's settle for a film rather than a novel. What did that film do to you? That did it touch you in a meaningful way, so that you felt you saw the world around you differently? What did it do? There is segregation in society. Okay, let me put it like this. You read about segregation by race or ethnicity in To Kill a Mockingbird. Did it enable you to see more clearly, perceive how there is discrimination or segregation on the basis of other things like caste and gender in our society? Did it sort of make some kind of personal, were you able to correlate in some personal manner with it? Did it encourage you to see how biases operate? It did? Okay, I hope it did. I've sort of given you the answer myself, but is anybody else? Catch 22 maybe. Has anyone read Catch 22? You have read Catch 22. Come on, what, Catch 22 is such an exciting novel. What did it do? Yes. That's okay. Very good, very, very good. This is a brilliant answer. Okay, so you've said already several things that I want to take ahead. The first thing you have said is that it problematizes this whole notion of patriotism, because if you, and please please read Catch 22 when you get a chance, because what it does is to disturb you in a way that I think good novels should do. That's one of the things I put up as a requirement of why we read literature. Literature disturbs us. Catch 22 disturbs you, because, you know, one of the ideals we never question is the ideal of patriotism, and that is precisely the ideal that Catch 22 meddles around with and makes you wonder about, because the kind of people who are endorsing that patriotism in this novel are dubious people, and then it makes you wonder whether patriotism itself has to be redefined in a certain way. But it's even more interesting, what did it help you to do? The second thing that you said was it enabled you to see the world around you. Okay, very good. Yes, that of course, perspective, that is another thing that good fiction does. It gives you perspective. It enabled her to see how petty her own problems were, in which case, I think this was a very, very useful sort of time out for her. It gave her something. It may not have given her a competence in the sense that learning something more fact-filled gives, but it did help her to see her own problem in perspective, and I think that's a very important thing. I believe you have been, I believe there have been some novels which are going to be distributed to you, and one of those novels I think is To Kill a Mockingbird. Now, at the risk of this sounding completely new to you and alien to you because you've not read it, I don't think many people here have read it, I'll still give a couple of examples from To Kill a Mockingbird. You can later go back when you get the novel and look at it, you know, and see, match what I'm saying to what you read in the book. So one of the things that literature does, why you should read literature, is that it promotes empathy, okay? It promotes empathy because when you're reading a book or an imagined, you know, story, especially a story which is written in the first person, you know, what it is to be written in the first person, when the character says, I did this, I went there, I went here, etc. Very soon you become the I, because our reading habit enables us to identify so totally with the I. That's how the first person pronoun works, that you are very soon yourself in the shoes of the person who is living life in the page, through the pages of that book. So what happens to that person is in some sense happening to you in your imagination. Otherwise you couldn't really read a book. You couldn't really read a book with a certain sense of distance between you and the protagonist. So you are already, the first step towards empathy has already happened when you are putting yourself in the shoes of somebody else. What To Kill a Mockingbird does, even though there is no first person narrator, what this novel does is to encourage empathy far more than most other novels I know. And I think this is because the novel is narrated by a child, and children have a very unbiased, refreshing picture of the world around them. So it's easier for you to get into the shoes of a child. We have all been children. Not all of us have been women. Some of us have not been men, etc., etc. So gender is a problem, but childhood is never a problem. We've all been children. So you can easily see what worries this child, because she is a child and she has not lost the innocence. Most of us as adults lose our innocence and become cynical. Now this is a novel which enables you to look again at the world around you, at the hypocrisies around you, at the institutions around you, as if a child would look, as if you would have looked at it as a child. Okay, so it builds empathy. In fact, the biggest takeaway from this novel is the lesson that this child learns, that you have to put yourself in somebody else's shoes in order to see the world that person sees. And why is it important to empathize? I mean, just look around you, look at the amount of intolerance we see everywhere. I hope there's going to be no two views about there is intolerance everywhere. Are we a very tolerant bunch of people on this universe? Hardly. I mean, we're so intolerant of everybody else because we have such strong opinions, and our opinions are so strong that we can't give anybody else the right to hold a different opinion. I don't think this is a good thing at all. I try generally not to use words like good and bad, but this I will categorically say is not at all a good thing. And if you don't believe me, please read this essay by Foster called Tolerance. He calls it a middle class, but a very, very important virtue. Okay, so I think that you can't tolerate difference, and we have to tolerate difference because we are living with differences all the time, and differences can enrich us. There's no need to be alienated by difference, and you can't do that if you didn't have empathy. So have I sold you the first reason for why you should read literature, that it builds empathy? Yes or no? Do you have any questions to ask about this, or shall I just go on and talk about more things? Shall I just go ahead? Yeah, you have a question? Ask. I like questions. No? Don't have a question. Okay. So, yeah, please ask. Which is very motivational. You know, sorry, I'm interrupting you. I get your point. But I don't think novels are meant to be motivational. You know, you have self-help books to be motivational. I think what a novel should do, and it's very difficult really for me to give to sort of prove this in a 1 hour lecture, but what I, for example, this is why, sorry, I wouldn't call Ayn Rand's books novels. Did we discuss Ayn Rand in reading fiction? Yes, we did. So, Ayn Rand can be seen either as motivational or non-motivational, for example. But a novel, I don't think, gives any one simple message. I think what a novel will do is to throw you into a situation, problematize that situation, so there are no easy answers to whatever questions are facing you there. But what I meant by empathy, yeah, I know I made the mistake perhaps of saying you empathize with the narrator, you empathize, but there are narrators you cannot empathize with as well. If you have read I couldn't empathize with Crime and Punishment, but if you have read Clockwork Orange, not a Clockwork Orange, okay, don't read it. Or even if you read it, don't empathize with the narrator, please, because he loves violence. So what I meant by, he does, I mean, I can't help it. So What I mean by empathizing with a narrator or empathizing or, you know, creating the sense of tolerance is to recognize that there can be more than one way of looking at something. That's what empathy does eventually, you know. Isn't it? I mean, if I am a woman and I'm empathizing with a man, I've already realized what it is to be a man in a world which I think as a woman is a man's world. May not be. Things like that. That's what I meant. So please take sort of larger pictures of the ideas I'm giving you and not the narrow pictures, because literal ways of understanding can again disturb or interfere with the way in which you understand how literature helps. So I'm going to now give you a provocative idea here. I've got this idea from a book called Reading Lolita in Tehran. Okay. I'll give you a very brief background to that book, and then I will tell you what she says. The author is Azhar Nafisi. Okay. I'll tell you what she says about what fiction does, coming from her own personal experience. And then this is a little more provocative than saying that literature simply encourages empathy. We can say yes and get on with it, right? Okay, so reading, I don't know if anybody here has read Reading Lolita in Tehran. Nobody has read it? Okay. So Lolita, everybody knows what Lolita is or who wrote Lolita and what it is all about, even though they have not read Lolita, right? Who wrote Lolita? They don't even know who wrote Lolita. Poor Nabokov was famous not because of him, but because of Lolita. Okay, Lolita is this greatly sensationalist novel which came out at some point, and it disappointed a lot of people who were hoping that it would be pornographic. That's what Nabokov says. I'm not making this up. So this is actually a memoir. This is not really a novel, okay? But this is a memoir, Reading Lolita in Tehran, written by Azhar Nafisi, who was a university professor in Tehran, who resigned from her post after the Iranian revolution because she could not, my recollection is that she refused to wear the veil. That's why she resigns, because she says she will not fall in line with the state's diktat about how she should dress when she goes to university and so on. What she does is, and she is a professor of English literature, what she does later is that she convenes on every Thursday a secret group of students, ex-students from her university who come to her house, and then they read books. And the books they read are fiction, they read novels, okay? And the first thing you should recognize here is that this is already a subversive act. You know what subversive is? What is subversion? How? Subversion is opposing. How is it different from confrontation? Yeah, you're not doing it openly, but you're basically subverting this. So this is what the students and the professor are doing here. They're subverting the rule which says that they should not read literature or whatever the rule was. They're not confronting the state, but they're subverting it. And they're getting the better of the state. And how do they do it? The first novel that they read is Lolita. Now, for those of you who don't, somebody must have read Lolita. You can quickly tell us what Lolita is about. So, can you hear him? Twelve-year-old nymphet, Humbert.
His name is Humbert. Yeah, he doesn't want love. It's more of sexual desire, and it's problematic because the girl is 12 years old and he is, I think, in mid-30s or mid-40s, and the entire novel is about how he pursues her, and I mean that's what the entire novel is.
Allah, she completely disappointed me. The entire novel is about confusion and exaggerating as usual. Thank you very much.
The novel is about how he claims that she is seducing him. That's the whole point, right? Okay, so you get the point here. It's very difficult, really, and you also should take a while to admire the talent of a man like Nabokov, who could make a man claiming to be innocent give away his culpability. You see what I mean? Here is Humbert, who says that girl is seducing me. First of all, it should occur to anybody who's got half a brain that she's 12 and he's 40 or 100 or whatever, and how can she be seducing him? But the fact is, Nabokov makes Humbert himself reveal that he is the one who is I don't even want to call it seduction, probably raping her, and then calling it and then blaming her for it. Now, this is not a very unfamiliar kind of situation, right? I don't want to get on in this track, but I want to leave you with this idea that perhaps this is not a very uncommon formula, that, you know, somebody else is blamed for being for seducing me, whereas he's the one who's after her. Now what happens, so reading Lolita in Tehran starts with the group, the study group reading Lolita. How does this book, reading this book, help them in any way to encounter their own reality? What is their reality? They are living in a repressive, oppressive regime. There is no freedom. There is nothing that they can do. They are in the control of a tyrant. And Nafisi puts this very imaginatively. She says that their reality has already been scripted by the state. So I want to now introduce you to this notion, which is a slightly sort of philosophical, quasi-philosophical and metaphorical notion, that we construct our realities and we have a certain amount of freedom in choosing what realities we want to live in. Are you able to get what I'm saying, or do you want to contest it, or do you want me to elaborate on it? Supposing I say, I mean, obviously it's not true that I can choose to eat a cake right now in front of you, and if I want I can choose to construct that reality, but it's not in that literal fashion that I'm talking about reality. Supposing somebody is telling you that you are, you know, worthless, or that you should not read something, and that person's reality requires that you should obey him. You have the freedom to disobey that person. To that extent, you have the freedom to choose or construct your own reality, right? Now, what reading Lolita does to this group, they read Lolita and they are able to empathize, to come back to your question about empathy, they are able to empathize with Lolita because they see the injustice of what is happening to Lolita, and they are able to correlate it to the injustice that is happening to them. I am suggesting to you, and again it comes from Nafisi, that perhaps if they hadn't read Lolita, their own situation may not have been elaborated or amplified in such a clear-cut manner to them. The fact that they were being, their lives were being authored by a tyrant, the state, just as Lolita's profile is being authored, you know, univocally by this man, Humbert, is a common point of convergence between the lives of these people and the life of Lolita. And Lolita encourages them, in fact this is again something I'm quoting from the book, the Lolita, the book encourages them to give Humbert a name, sorry, give the state a name, or give Humbert also a name, tyrant, because they see Humbert as no different from the state which is oppressing them. They have already found ways of subverting this oppression, and that is by reading. So there are two things that I think, you know, reading literature has actually enabled them here. First, it's given them the time to, or the opportunity to escape from an oppressive regime by reading in a, you know, reading. When you're reading, you've forgotten your reality, right? I'll come back to this escapist part of reading a little later. But reading is a form of escapism. Many people read in order to escape. I mean, this reality is so unpleasant, let me read a novel, or let me read a poem, or let me read something which is a fantasy, which is happy, where I have some control over what happens. So essentially, if you lose all control over the world that you live in, the real world, and that control is in the hands of a tyrant, it can be terribly unpleasant. But if you recognize that person is a tyrant, and then you're able to laugh at the tyrant, it's very difficult, but you should try. If you can laugh at the tyrant, then the tyrant has already lost his power over you. Can you recognize this as an idea that you can, or if you want me to repeat this, I will repeat it. Did you get what I'm saying? That you have to, you know, you don't have to be crushed by a powerful opponent. I think this idea is not developed to this happy conclusion in 1984, but 1984 says the same thing, right? People have read 1984. I think that's also on the list of the novels that is going to be given. What happens in 1984? A man who dares to think something that the state doesn't let him think. He's taken to the torture chamber, and then he's sort of put on a bed, I think, and some pain, a pain is applied to him. And this is what I mean by somebody who wants to control your reality. The man's name is Winston, and then there is a machine that he's attached to, and the pain that he is forced to suffer is increased. And the man who is sort of applying the pressure is the tyrant, and he tells him, he shows him two fingers, and he says, how many fingers do you see? And Winston initially says two. Sorry. So the jailer says, no, I show you two, but you are, and I say it's four. I show you two, I say it's four, you have to see four. So Winston says, why should I do that? I have the freedom to see and say what I want to see and say, and you can't crush my individuality or my freedom to say what I want to say. But when the pain gets unbearable, Winston, just to buy, you know, relief, says, I see two. But you know what this man says, and that's where the crux of this whole oppression, power, etc. lies. This man tells him, I know you're saying that you're seeing two because it's painful. I don't want you to say two, I want you to see. did I say two or four, whatever it is, I want you to see what I asked you to see. You see how much control a tyrant can exercise over your imagination. And I think that's precisely the point of imagination. Imagination is something that nobody can restrict. Winston is being punished or, you know, tortured to such an extent that his mind will become a puppet of the mind of the man who is punishing him, so that he can only see what that man asks him to see, not pretend to see, actually see. That's so scary, isn't it? So literature, I think, enables you to ask the questions that can only come by liberating your imagination. And that's a point that this Lolita, this book, Leading Lolita in Tehran, makes evident. Okay, so read it at some point, and then see how the way in which you go to reading a purely imagined work can enable you to cope with your reality, to understand your reality. I, in fact, have an even a simpler kind of reason for why you should escape. But before I get there, I also want to give you this example from Midnight's Children, because that might be a novel many people have read, Midnight's Children. Okay. So in Midnight's Children, doesn't matter, in Midnight's Children, many things happen. But one of the things that happen in Midnight's Children is that Saleem Sinai, the narrator, is contrasting India with Pakistan. India, Midnight's Children are the children of midnight, and the midnight is the glorious midnight of our freedom, 14th of August 1947. He is contrasting India and Pakistan. Now, what Saleem Sinai is doing, this novel is basically a glorification of the value of democracy. The freedom to be able to say what you want to say, express your opinion, etc., etc. So he says, and he puts it in this way, Saleem Sinai says, there's a difference between India and Pakistan. The difference between India and Pakistan is that India is not actually a nation. It's a collective dream that all Indians are dreaming. And we are free to dream and imagine whatever India we want. That's why what you see as an India may be very different from the India that I see. But he says, the reality of Pakistan is a state-sponsored reality. He gives an interesting example of the different Indias in India by saying that, you know, if you open the newspaper, you can, he says, you open the newspaper. I haven't read a newspaper in a long time, so spare me. If you read a newspaper, open a newspaper, you will actually, he sees examples of, he sees stories about how a child was discovered with two heads, one head was actually the head of a bullock and so on. And he says, this is also in India where people believe these things. People do believe these things, right? I mean, and they have the freedom to believe it. And belief is, your belief is your reality. Are you able to at least see that? To a large extent, what you believe is what is real for you. And a novel can make you sort of believe in that kind of reality by simply opening you up to the possibility of that reality. Do you get what I'm saying? Are you all sort of, you all agree with me? Please somebody disagree so we can have a healthy debate. No. Okay. So this is what I wanted to say. What's wrong with escapism? So do you all read fantasy? I mean, I know, again, this is another simplification, oversimplification. All engineering students like fantasy. Am I right?
No.
Yes. Why do you read fantasy? Palash is Game of Thrones fantasy. Oh, thank God. Why do you read fantasy? Who reads fantasy? This has to be a very specific question. Do you read fantasy? No, you've already answered. You're the only one answering all the time. Harry Potter is fantasy. Come on, everybody reads Harry Potter? No? Okay, so why do you read Harry Potter? Do you think some profound truths about reality are hidden in Harry Potter? They could be if you want. But why do you read fantasy? To escape from this world, right? It's the ultimate form of escape. It's better than other kinds of novels. There's nothing in the Harry Potter world, except perhaps strict schoolmasters. But I don't know whether school teachers are strict anymore. So which can really remind you of this world at all. So what is wrong with escapism? You think there's something wrong with escapism? This is my least sort of passionate defense of why we read literature. But I think we should also sort of allow this reason to exist for why we read literature. What is wrong with wanting to escape? And you never know, when you escape, you might actually discover something. Something might trigger your imagination, which might actually come back and help you look at reality in a different way. I mean, I said it for him, he didn't say it, but reading To Kill a Mockingbird, which is about bias of a certain kind, trains you to understand and recognize how bias can operate in your own context, in your own society, maybe not race, but something else. Maybe it's gender, maybe it's something else. And recognition is always the first step towards changing the reality, yes or no. If you can't even see a problem in your reality, then you wouldn't even be bothering to change it. But perhaps, and I'm sure you agree that change is important. And change is something that technology does on a very predictable basis, right? But change is something that even literature can do if you open your imagination to why you read. Okay, I want to, I had given, I had distributed this Saki short story to them. I don't know if anybody has read it. You did read it? Okay, so those of you who have read the, you also read it, The Open Window. Those of you who, of course you must have read The Open Window. I made you read it in both your courses. Saki? No? All right. So those of you who have read The Open Window, do you want to sort of ask me anything about it? If only, you know, why I asked you to read it? How many of you did read The Open Window? That's amazing. Okay, why did you read it? I mean, what did you feel after reading it? Why did I read it? Did you feel, why did I read it? Ah, you were curious why I selected this, okay. This was just to see if you have certain questions about that short story, which might be very basic questions about understanding how literature works at all. You, how many of you did read it here, this now? Okay, so I wanted to ask whether you think the people who came in at the end are really people or ghosts? Why are they not ghosts? You know that Vera has said in the beginning that they are ghosts. What has enabled you to conclude? Do all of you believe that they are not ghosts? The last line, very good. Okay, anything else? This is a good example of what I would call over-interpretation. And because if that were true, then later on, the aunt would not have been surprised at why he was running away. She is also surprised. Remember how dismissively she speaks about him. He was talking about his own illnesses all the time, and I found him very morbid or something. Okay. Anything else? It's interesting. I see, okay. So you're saying that these people wanted to know, so why would ghosts bother about who that man is? Okay, all right. I also thought, if you look at the text itself, at nowhere does the text show a and we've seen the entire conversation between Vera and this Frampton. But there's no place where she has told him about this Ganges and the Banaras thing and the hounds. Right? So clearly she has been lying, and if you also read a little carefully, you'll find that at the beginning she is making very sure that he knows nobody there. She has said that, you know, do you know anybody? Do you have letters of introduction? And then, yeah, she asks him twice. I don't remember that. Very good reading. Yeah, she asks him that, you know, do you know anybody? And then having ensured that he knows nothing and nobody, so that, because if he knew, then he would know that these people are real people. And I think she at that point just couldn't resist telling that story about how, of course, it was also, there is a certain amount of coincidence that day also they said the same words were uttered by the people who came in through the window. But anyway, we shouldn't ask too many uncomfortable questions about. Okay. Now, what I'm going to end with is this, okay, one last question. Have you read Hard Times? And if you haven't read, I don't blame you at all. It's a very difficult novel to read. It's a very boring novel. But I'm going to use Hard Times to make two points. One point I'm going to make through Hard Times about this very famous philosopher called Martha Nussbaum, who has written this book called Poetic Justice. She is a professor of philosophy who taught a language on law, who taught a course on law and literature in the University of Chicago, where she was actually making a case. So maybe she should have come to give this talk about why literature. She was making a case for why it's important for judges and lawyers to have read literature before they went into a court of law, before they pronounced verdicts or gave judgments. You must also have noticed, or if you haven't, you will now, that I'm using the word literature as if we are all agreed about what are the good books to read and what are not the good books to read. There are a lot of these questions which are, you know, are implicit in so many of the things I have said, but I'm not addressing those questions now because they will just take away from the main topic. Like, you know, that was one of the things that occurred to me when you asked me about how can I empathize with, you know, and somebody said Chetan Bhagat. So I personally wouldn't put Chetan Bhagat in the same league as Charles Dickens. But anyway, so this is just to say that you have nothing but my word at this point in time for why some literature is good and some literature and qualifies as literature and the others qualify as trash or whatever. Okay, now, so she says, and so it's with this general understanding of this is what constitutes literature and these things don't constitute literature, that Martha Nussbaum decided to teach her students Hard Times. They read Hard Times, you can't teach the novel, read Hard Times and felt that reading that novel was important, just as another novel by Ralph Ellison called The Invisible Man. She read that also as part of that law course, so that she felt that judges, especially when they were giving judgment, should be empathetic to the criminals or to the, I don't want to use the word victims, to the people they were judging. So the importance of emotion in public life. And there is why, or there is where she found a value for literature. That literature was useful because reading literature sensitized them in a certain way. It's like music, it sensitizes you in a certain way, so it probably makes you more human. And where law is pushing you towards being objective, there is a danger of being too objective, not being able to see the human side of a story, where literature comes in and enables you to look at it. Okay, this was the point that she made. So poetic justice, you probably know what poetic justice means. Poetic justice means, so if you in a story or in a novel, you have good characters being rewarded and bad characters being punished, then it is believed that, I mean, you say that that novel works with, on the principle of poetic justice. So that's what she means by poetic justice. So through Martha Nussbaum, I'm going to read a little bit of Hard Times. I'll give you a brief introduction to Hard Times. You can always read it later. It's not showing on the screen. I can see it here, but it's not showing. Okay, I'll give you a very brief introduction to, because I'm going to read excerpts from chapter 2. Okay, I'm just going to read excerpts, so it's important. Let him do what he wants to do. Please listen to me. I'm going to read excerpts from chapter 2. And because they are excerpts, let me just briefly tell you what the context of this chapter is. Okay, there is this man who has established a school called the Gradgrind School. His name is Thomas Gradgrind. He will figure in this chapter. Then there is a schoolmaster called Chokum Child. Can you guess? He is Chokum Child. He chokes children with facts. That's why he's called Chokum Child. Those of you who are familiar with Dickens' style will know that the kind of names that he brings out are, you know, very telling. And then they are addressing a class of students, okay? And this is something I'm sure you can relate to. You're all sitting here, and I hope I'm no Chokum Child, but you can just sort of just look at the way in which this is, this class is happening. And also remember, once I finish reading this chapter, it's a short chapter, and I will only read excerpts, so don't worry. There is a bit that I will read about how Thomas Gradgrind is introduced in this first paragraph. And please notice this title of the chapter, it's called Murdering the Innocents. So what Dickens means by this is that by filling them with facts, he actually uses the verb filling them. This man, this teacher sees the children, the students sitting in front of him as pitchers, jugs, into which facts after fact has to be crammed. And that is where I find, you know, that I can slip in this idea of imaginative literature as a counter to these facts. Anyway, so this is Thomas Gradgrind who runs the school. For those of you who have heard of John Stuart Mill, and okay, so this was this famous utilitarian philosophy. J.S. Mill, you don't know. Okay, so that's the philosophy that the greatest good of the greatest number was his utilitarian philosophy, which is being very virulently caricatured and attacked by Charles Dickens in the characters here. So look at this, Thomas Gradgrind, sir, a man of realities. Notice that there is implicit condemnation of this man having no imagination. A man of facts and calculations. A man who proceeds upon the principle that 2 and 2 are 4 and nothing over, and who is not to be talked into allowing for anything over. Don't tell me 2 and 2 are 4. I know. But there could be situations where you could imagine that it could be something else. All right, Thomas Gradgrind, sir, peremptorily Thomas, with a rule and a pair of scales and the multiplication table always in his pocket, sir, ready to weigh and measure any parcel of human nature and tell you exactly what it comes to. So here again, I will say that where knowledge can be quantified, the knowledge that you get from certain disciplines, knowledge from literature cannot be quantified. I can't tell you that if you read this novel, this is what you will get out of it, or this will change you into such and such person. Even that much guarantee I can't give you. But it will familiarize you with context which you might not have imagined before, which may actually happen, come to happen in your life later on. So then something that happens in your life may put you in mind of a book that you read and help you to understand what's happened to you. If it's intangible, I can't help it, but that's how it works. Okay, it's a mere question of figures.
It's a mere question of figures.
Where is it?
A case of simple arithmetic. You might hope to get some other, etc. I'm going to read this. Now, I'm going to leave this. And now, I will talk about how he addresses his students. Girl number 20, said Mr. Gradgrind, squarely pointing with his square forefinger. Dickens is deliberately using the image of square to show that he has no corners or he has no rounded edges. I don't know that girl. Who's that girl? Sissy Jupe, sir, explained number 20, blushing, standing up and curtsying. Sissy is not a name, said Mr. Gradgrind. Don't call yourself Sissy. Call yourself Cecilia. He doesn't approve of shortenings. His father has called me Sissy, sir, returned the young girl. Then he has no business to do it. So this is a man, again, a caricature and a funny version of a tyrant. All right, now, then, you know, what he does is, he asks her to define, to give a definition of a horse. And he comes to this because she says, my father is a trainer of horses. So he says, okay, you define what a horse is. And she is unable to define a horse. And see here, girl number 20, unable to define a horse, said Mr. Gradgrind, for the general behoof of all the little pitchers. The little pitchers are the students into whom facts have to be thrown. Girl number 20, possessed of no facts in reference to one of the commonest of animals. Some boy's definition of a horse. Bitzer, yours. Now, Bitzer, you will find, is a model student of the school. So let's see how Bitzer is described. And I also want you to notice how something very natural and poetic like the sunlight is described with respect to these two characters, so that you are encouraged to understand these two characters in the way the author wants you to. The square finger moving here and there lighted suddenly on Bitzer, perhaps because he chanced to sit in the same ray of sunlight which darting in at one of the bare windows of the intensely whitewashed room irradiated Sissy. For the boys and girls sat on the face of the inclined plane in two compact bodies. You're familiar with this kind of arrangement, no? Divided up the center by a narrow interval. And Sissy, being at the corner of a row on the sunny side, came in for the beginning of a sunbeam, of which Bitzer, being at the other end or the other corner of a row on the other side, a few rows in advance, caught the end. You see what Dickens is doing? He's describing a sunbeam. Yeah, yeah, very good. But whereas the girl was so dark-eyed and dark-haired that she seemed to receive a deeper and more lustrous color from the sun when it shone upon her, the boy was so light-eyed and light-haired that the self-same rays appeared to draw out of him what little color he ever possessed. His cold eyes would hardly have been eyes but for the short ends of lashes which were bringing them into immediate contrast with something paler than themselves expressed their form. So he's basically trying to show how one is so imaginatively, one is so full of life and the other is so dead. And look at his definition of a horse. Quadruped, graminivorous, 40 teeth, namely 24 grinders, 4 eye teeth and 12 incisive. Sheds coats in the spring. In marshy countries, sheds hooves too. Hooves hard but requiring to be shod with iron. Age known by marks and mouth. So this is the kind of answer that somebody who's so fact-driven like Gradgrind wants and gets from a model student of his school. Now, this is itself, I think, funny or, you know, disturbing enough. But what happens now, and with this I will stop. Okay. This is the problem that Gradgrind. Now, what is Gradgrind's policy? One is to cram the children with facts, and the other is to make sure that they have no imagination at all, because imagination is deadly to fact. There is an implicit opposite here, no, polarizing. So he says, girl number 20, will you carpet your room or your husband's room, if you were a grown woman and had a husband, with representations of flowers? If you please, sir, I would, because I'm fond of flowers. Is that why you would put tables and chairs upon them and have people walking over them with heavy boots? It wouldn't hurt them, sir. They wouldn't crush and wither, if you please, sir. They would be the pictures of what was very pretty and pleasant. And I would fancy, aye, but you mustn't fancy, cried the gentleman, quite elated by coming so happily to his point. That's it, you're never to fancy. Okay? You can read the rest of it later. Basically, what is happening here is, Thomas Gradgrind is so anti-imagination that even if a carpet were to have flowers on it simply because they look nice, he objects to it because he says in reality we don't walk on flowers, okay, carpets with flowers. And later he talks about the wallpapering of a room, and she says, I will wallpaper it with something, I think with animals. And he says, in real life you don't have animals walking over walls, so how can you have wallpaper with animals? I mean, this is of course a complete caricature of the whole idea of imagination, but a caricature is one of the tools of Dickens, he always makes his point by exaggeration and ridicule, which is what caricature does. So I thought I'll end it, this whole talk of why we need literature, in the words of Dickens. And now you feel free to ask me whatever questions you want. You want to go. It's been a 1 hour long lecture, I understand. Yes. Open window, yeah. Yeah, so basically, I've had responses to that story saying that they were not people but ghosts. Yes. So that has always worried me deeply because I thought if that was the level of understanding of what literature is, there's a real problem. I mean, then how do I tell you that no? Because, then I have to find reasons. I mean, the most obvious reason why they can't be ghosts is then where's the story? That's the whole thing, yes. Romance at short notice was a speciality. But there are people who have read that and still they feel that. Made it up. No, Saraswati, I'm sorry to say that there are people who've read the entire thing and still fight about the fact that they are not ghosts. So I thought if we are going to have discussions on that level, then there might be a different way of approaching this question of how do we understand that something is a story? See, essentially it's a story, no? It's not a newspaper report which says that actually there were ghosts who came in. And the point is if they were really ghosts, then there would be no story value to it. But we have to have an instinct for understanding what constitutes a story. If we didn't have that instinct, then much of what I say about why literature matters may not have any relevance. Yes. If you read it, maybe you wouldn't ask this question, but all right, ask. I think your question is about what makes certain books great literature and why should they always be difficult to read. You didn't say it in so many words, but I think somewhere you are saying that. Why is it difficult reading? I'm not saying that Sidney Sheldon is a bad writer, although I haven't read Sidney Sheldon in a long time, but I recently read a Jeffrey Archer, which I quite liked. I don't know. I feel that if I can anticipate the plot and the plot doesn't have anything great to tell me in terms of discovery of life or myself or anything, I wouldn't classify it as great literature. So I read the first of those five things. What was it? Where There's a Will, is it? Jeffrey Archer, Where There's a Will or something. Is it Where There's a Will? No, it's not Where There's a Will. I can't remember the title, unfortunately. But so I could predict what was happening. And I thought, I felt when I read it that, I spent so much time reading something and I felt cheated at the end of that book. This is not to say all Jeffrey Archers cheat or that others who read the same book should feel cheated in the same manner. But I want to say two things. I want to say one, that actually people don't read much at all. The last, I think, 10 or 20 years, there's been so little reading happening on a general scale because there are other forms of entertainment. In my childhood, there wasn't even a television, so there was nothing else to do after I came back from school except take a book and read. That was the only thing. So when you keep reading on a very regular basis, Victorian sentences don't seem difficult at all. This is my experience because people of my generation who have not read, who have not studied English literature will tell you the same thing. They haven't found, because reading was available, it was easy and it took you into a different world. Now this question of, the other question that you raised, I think is a question of genre, no? So you have thrillers, you want to read thrillers. Yeah, read thrillers. I mean, you're reading Sidney Sheldon. But surely, if you were a lawyer, I'm sure you can learn something from The Rage of Angels. Rage of Angels? is a Sidney Sheldon novel. You read Rage of Angels. So I think if you read Rage of Angels, I mean, it will give you very good ideas about how, and if you want to be a lawyer, in fact, I would tell Martha Nussbaum to put Rage of Angels there. So, no, there is a certain snob value attached with literature, which I think is what you're saying. I agree, but I feel that lately, especially with Game of Thrones and so on, the snob value has completely gone. And in fact, there's some kind of a reverse snobbishness working where you say, Charles Dickens, oh, you should read Game of Thrones. Am I caricaturing this Pallash for you? Or Neil Gaiman. I think you should read Neil Gaiman. Fantasy and escapism. Because Neil Gaiman says, he's a fantasy writer, he says, what's wrong with escapism? He says, we have this obligation to read and escape. If you read Great Expectations, I'm sorry I interrupted you, but the thought just came. If you read Great Expectations, if you had been able to read it through or at least watch the film. You mean literally or symbolically? No, I'll tell you why. This is because, you know, when we are readers, we read the same book many times. So the first time I read it, maybe even I would have thought, what pictures? Then I go back, I come back. But reading requires a lot of both patience and application. And I, again, like to say that the great novels will take that patience and application from you because they have something really nice to give. Which was a different generation, no? P.G. Woodhouse, you read, you laugh, you forget. Great Expectations, you take with you. You take with you through various situations in life. I don't know about hard times, because hard times is about trade unions and so on and so forth. I wasn't so impressed by Hard Times. It's a difficult novel to read because it's quite boring. But Great Expectations, if you had, it would have paid you. If you had read till the end of it, or if you go back and read it. If you hadn't left it midway, and if you had looked at the way it amazingly ends, it's a book that will make you, you know, want to reflect a lot. And I think anything that encourages the exercise of the gray cells is a good thing. Yeah, that's a common problem, but I think it's a multi-pronged problem. People don't read anymore. Reading has gone out of fashion. Why should I read when I can watch a film? And why do they write so in such a difficult way? How dare they write like this so that, you know, they make it difficult for me to read? So when the questions towards books have themselves changed so much, so I can't give the old answers anymore. All I can say is read. And it's up to you to read or not to read. And I can say this is good literature, this is not good literature. But Clockwork Orange is great literature. But having said that, I think if you don't worry too much about whether you've understood it right and just jump into the novel, you can read it. And I'm saying this because I recently have been offering, for 3 or 4 semesters, I've been offering a course on Shakespeare. It's a Shakespearean adaptations course. But because I'm an English teacher and I like reading Shakespeare, I insist that we read some Shakespeare. You won't believe it, and these are students of engineering, and they have their usual reservations about literature and so on. Sorry. But after the first time I took it, they didn't want to read the adaptations or watch the film. They wanted to read Shakespeare because it's just the first 2 or 3 pages which are difficult. Once you get the hang of it, you can't stop reading because reading works like that. So they found Shakespeare far more interesting because he was saying interesting things in a very unusual way. See? So these pictures, for example, if you think about it, this whole notion of cramming a picture with facts, doesn't that explain a certain kind of educational system so beautifully, so succinctly? And you have to take time out to appreciate the beauty. That's what literature does. It's not about facts, where you understand what's happening. We all understand so many things. But the way in which we understand, I think, is as important as what we understand, because it determines what you understand. And how much you remember what you understand, and how much you apply what you understand to your own real life situation. Thank you for that question. It was a very good question. You have a question. A question has been looking at me from you for a long time. No, nobody's challenging anything that I said. Come on, please challenge. Yes. Nothing. You want to add to anything that has been discussed or? So there's a problem, I'll stop now, with the problem of interpretation, that why I said, you know, she says, Azan Afisi says, a good work of fiction should disturb you. So I think that when you read a novel, a really good novel, and read it in the way it should be read, you don't go back with very categorical answers to problems or issues, but I think you go back with more questions. You ask yourself things that you were not asking yourself before. In that respect, I'm sure many of you have read Julius Caesar, at least in school. Okay, so, all right. So, if you compare it to 1984, 1984 is very ideological because it says that totalitarian states are bad. I'm not going to contest that ideology, but I think being ideological takes away from some of the multifacetedness of this. If you look at Julius Caesar, the story of Julius Caesar as written by Shakespeare, how are you going to interpret the conspiracy and the assassination? What does it tell you about Julius Caesar? Does it tell you, I mean, what does it tell you about totalitarianism? Does it say that if you are a totalitarian dictator, you will get assassinated? Or does it tell you that, or does it say that if you are a totalitarian dictator, you should get assassinated? Or does it say that if you assassinate a dictator, you can't get away by assassinating him, there'll be a Mark Antony? What is it telling you? It's telling you all of these things across different stages of the play, right? So this notion of problematizing something, making it impossible for you to oversimplify any understanding, I think that's what literature. Thank you.